It's a real pleasure to introduce Anjum. There's one thing, Arvind Krishna Mehrotra is in the audience. There's one thing, one very interesting point he makes in his book Partial Recall about writers who curate, and discover a literary tradition. And there's a wonderful moment about, I think both Arvind and Amit have talked about how the excitement of a literature discovering itself when a writer of a later period goes back and discovers somebody earlier. And I think Arvind's argument is that that's not happening enough. And Anjum Hasan is one of the rare writers writing today who really does this beautifully, who's a wonderful curatorial energy, identifying different traditions, not just in English, but in Hindi. I think of later preoccupation has been with Hindi language and literature and how that works, but also in English, you know, just the way. And of course, that is underwritten by her role as the books editor of Caravan magazine. And, you know, so which is what something that shows so much in her own writing, in her own fiction and poetry. Her latest novel, The Cosmopolitan, has been kind of has almost fallen into the sort of cliched description of being described as a novel of ideas, which has its own baggage. But it's very clear why Anjum is repeatedly identified as a novelist of ideas, and that kind of hallowed European tradition of novel of ideas in the tradition of Tolstoy, Mann, and going down to James Coetzee and other writers. So, and Anjum's, and this is probably also has a lot to do with the fact that Anjum's most contemporary preoccupation is with the idea of the contemporary itself. And this is something I know not just from reading her work, but from endless conversations with her, at multiple locations, that what is the nature of the contemporary? Why are so few writers writing about the contemporary? I mean, why do we fall back on the past? Why is it in some ways easier to fall back on memory or nostalgia or a certain kind of temporal otherness? Why is the contemporary slippery? And I think one of Anjum's most pointed project is this challenging dimension of writing about contemporary life, which is really forbidding because it's just like literature. The contemporary is very hard to understand unless there's some distance between us, some time has passed. In other words, when it's contemporary, no more. So that's a very brave and daring venture of Anjum as a novelist as well as a critic. I've also had the good fortune to read a couple of stories from her new collection, A Day in the Life, which is not out yet, but which will be out like in a month's time. And I see the same, you know, fascinating kind of idea of what does it mean to be a urban, often middle class Indian in a contemporary Indian city, and so that's a fascinating kind of a thing. But that's exactly what I think Anjum has driven Anjum through much of her writing life. But specifically, what I think will come alive in today's talk is her interest in multilingualism. You know, she's going to talk about Kiran Nagarkar, and I know Anjum's relationship with Hindi language and literature, as well as other Indian languages, is probably driving her forward to look at a writer who does not write only in English but also in another Indian language. So, with that, I will hand the stage to Anjum, and we'll have some discussion after she's spoken. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Saikat. And I think the word you used when you started, excitement, about one's contemporaries, about one's peers, but also about the writers who've gone on before, and how does one relate to them, is what is driving this paper, this piece that I've written on Kiran Nagarkar. And he's someone I have written about before, in the space that I occupy, which is that of sort of literary journalism, not academics at all, literary journalism, the essay. And I was trying to develop the idea in some of these essays I did, of which the one on Kiran Nagarkar was one, was how do you address the idea of the oeuvre of a writer? And I think we were so obsessed in the journalism space with the new, with the topical, with the latest book, with celebration, as Amit was talking about, that we don't have the space mentally, we don't have the space physically in the newspaper, in the magazine to actually discuss over it. And I think Nagarkar is a very fascinating example to discuss in relation to the idea of oeuvre, because his novels don't seem to proceed according to any conventional notions of oeuvre being like a sort of teleological progression towards something, maybe literary success, maybe adding up to a career, because each of his books is so deliberately different. Each seems to be a restarting. Each seems to cancel out the previous one. And that is why he is also, I think, very suited to the theme of this conference, which is against storytelling. Because I think he is both for and against, and he's able to deploy storytelling when he wants to, but also work in forms that are very, very, if not antagonistic, then at least in opposition to the idea of telling a story. So what difference does it make for and against storytelling while the novels of Kiran Nagarkar? Kiran Nagarkar's 1974 novel, Saath Sakkam Trechalis, Seven Sixes Are 43, in the English translation, is a modernist collage, fragmentary, dreamlike, sidestepping linearity and conclusiveness. Its hero repeatedly coming up against the absurdity of middle-class life, religious belief, and most recurrently, romantic love. The novel describes the interior landscape of a dissolute and moneyless young man in Bombay and Pune of the 1960s and 70s. Kushank Purandare loves women, one after the other or simultaneously, but the novel is not a love story. He cannot submit romantic or erotic feelings to conventions such as monogamy or ideas of permanence and responsibility. And so the refrain of one of his lovers, "What difference does it make?" becomes a theme of the novel. After this novel, his first, Nagarkar would not publish another book till two decades later when Ravan and Eddie appeared. The place of Seven Sixes Are 43 in Nagarkar's oeuvre has usually been discussed in terms of language. He wrote this first novel in Marathi and then went on to write several more in English. And that move is seen as proof of his linguistic talents, or from the other side, it's also seen sometimes as a betrayal of his Marathi antecedents, that he wrote in Marathi a novel that was fairly sophisticated, and then he moved on to writing much more conventional fiction in English. So linguistic considerations in both cases. On its appearance, Seven Sixes Are 43 was considered unprecedented. Its Marathi was unfamiliar. One wag asked on hearing that it was going to be translated into English, but should it not be translated into Marathi first? And its discontinuous structure apparently befuddled early readers. But what the focus on Marathi versus English obscures is how far Nagarkar also shifted from that restrained, jagged rhetorical style of his debut to create the chatty, if not voluble, voice he used in Ravan and Eddie. In the latter, he seems to laugh off the searing angst that saturates Seven Sixes Are 43 to focus instead on the resilient, sometimes even joyful pragmatism of those who live in materially much more impoverished circumstances. It could also be that the India of the early 1990s, in which he was writing this second novel, was no longer the country in which a character such as Kushank Purandare, the young hero of that first novel, might convincingly essay his brooding lyricism. Ravan and Eddie is actually set in an earlier time, from the mid-40s to the early 1960s, but in tone it could be described as an Indian English novel of the 90s, exuberant, larger than life, and indubitably filmy in the resolve of its down and out characters to overcome life's challenges come what may. Other similarly effervescent novels of the same period that come to mind are Alan Seeley's Trotternama, Shashi Tharoor's Great Indian Novel, Mukul Keshavan's Looking Through Glass, and of course the novels of Salman Rushdie. Just 2 years after Ravan and Eddie was published, Nagarkar put out a third novel called Cuckold. And with this, a 600-page saga set in 16th century Rajasthan, he seemed to have reinvented himself all over again. If 7/6 are 43 is remarkable for the naked, bitter gaze of its hero on all of life, and for Nagarkar's subversions of the conventions of the realist novel, and Ravan and Eddie for the joy that makes cramp communal life in a Bombay chawl or tenement, however desperate, seem like a poignantly funny experience, then Cuckold compels for its sustained attention on the inner life of a medieval prince in a register that is somber, richly descriptive, and replete with the most finessed emotional nuances. The prince, the Maharaj Kumar, speaks to us mostly in first person, in a contemporary English idiom that makes surprisingly immediate the complex political life of the kingdom of Mewar, as well as his tortured relationship to his wife Meera, who would go on to become the popular poet saint Mirabai, a figure who has generally been thought of in fabula rather than historical terms. In Cuckold, there is none of the first novel's doubt about the significance and purpose of human action, nor is there any of the second novel's spirited colloquialism and its eulogizing of the allure of popular culture. Instead, the focus here has shifted to a consideration of the yawning gap between the public and the private, convention and desire, politics and love. I will come back to these three novels, which seem to have absolutely nothing in common, and I will explore Kiran Nagarkar's relationship to storytelling and its opposite via a slightly closer reading of all three books. But before that, I want to ask what storytelling is generally taken to mean today in relation to literature. There are two possibly related, but not always well argued for horrors that have given storytelling its contemporary appeal because it is meant to suggest an escape from them. One is the sin of boring people, and the other, the shibboleth of cultural elitism. Now, 3 years ago, I was speaking at on a panel at a literary festival with the novelist Manu Joseph and Zia Rehman Haider. The theme of the discussion was the literary novel, which Joseph, who more or less hijacked the discussion, unilaterally declared boring and alienating to readers. He did not provide examples, but from his comments, one inferred that the literary novel was the sort which won awards, sold poorly, and lacked a plot, and whose authors were persistent apologists for unreadability. That his own novel, Serious Men, had won a leading award not too long ago, and that it had sold well enough for him to make, for a time, a living from it, seemed to him only to cement his argument. Despite his vituperation, Joseph's point seemed to be a simple and banal one. That is, the market decides what is worthwhile fiction and everything else be damned. Joseph has, before and since, commented publicly on his distaste for contemporary Indian fiction in English. So I will use him here as an example of an attitude which, in being held by a practitioner of a genre he considers largely worthless, seems self-defeating. And yet it is not considered strange. Joseph's views are seen either as worth agreeing with or important to dismiss, but not paradoxical. Zia Rehman Haider did the latter during our discussion by upholding his right to cultivate his chosen aesthetic as a writer, even if such a practice is not rewarded by the market. But rarely is it noticed that arguments such as Joseph's imply a curious solipsism. They are an echo chamber in which each writer creates for himself the version of the novel that he has authorized. Now, there are several Indian English writers, I think, who have expressed a version of Manu Joseph's view, which is that what they're doing is legitimate as Indian English novelists, but the genre is a problem. And Amit was in his discussion with you before lunch was talking about the pre-modern and the modern, and you said you described yourself as a self-hating modernist. And so I would add you to this list that I'm compiling of Indian English writers who don't like themselves, or who like themselves. There is self-love, but there is also a curious embarrassment, the terms we've been using in the morning, dislike, shame of the genre. And I won't go into that right now, though I have some examples here. But I certainly think this is something I want to develop maybe in another essay. This embarrassment with the genre seems to me to have become intrinsic to it. For his part, Manu Joseph scoffs at those creators of so-called serious literature, and his charge is that this seriousness is a ploy for mediocrity. Those robust writers who have their ears to the ground know the value of storytelling for the masses, whereas only wishy-washy liberals disregard storytelling in the books they write, mainly for each other's mutual approbation. In a recent interview, Joseph said, quote, "I have a grouse about what is considered serious literature. The way activists," and I wondered if he was talking about literary activism actually here, the literary activism series, "the way activists have created a reward system for unreadable novels is a crime against art. So when social frailties are sold in the form of novels, which don't have any stories or anything, that irritates me," unquote. Probing Joseph's views further, one finds that he equates moral seriousness in art with ideological obduracy. He has written against activism in art, the move to replace what is entertaining and what is interesting with what is merely empathetic to all points of view. There is certainly here in India and elsewhere a growing conformism regarding how and who to represent, and an ever-ready willingness to take offense on behalf of one or another cultural identity. Joseph's first novel, Serious Men, a hilarious account of the brilliant conniving of a Dalit man to secure a place in the sun for his child, was criticized for its apparently negative portrayal of Dalits and also for its apparent misogyny. But Joseph conflates, in his views, such policing of literature with what is, or at least once was, a liberal Catholicity. And he strangely does not seem to notice that this, what he calls thuggish aspect of liberal politics, is in line with, even indistinguishable from, right-wing intolerance. So why then this willful neglect of the modern capabilities of liberalism? In the interview quoted above, Joseph points out that except as some lowly derivatives of the West, as Indians, quote, "we don't know what we are when we're modern." So here is again, like the self-dislike or the embarrassment that I referred to earlier, here again is a rejection of the very thing one is supposed to, by definition, be, a modern Indian. Now, this is not an estrangement of the kind that Kushank Purandare is subject to in 7/6 of 43, but a categorical, even cold-hearted dismissal of the possibilities of one's own singularity and specific experiences as an Indian. Joseph's latest novel, Miss Leela, Armed and Dangerous, while shaped like a thriller and so naturally replete with storytelling, is also aimed at ridiculing both liberal eggheads and hardened right-wingers. This is at best only mildly amusing. It is also indicative of where Joseph thinks storytelling can take us. If nothing has value, then the only role left to entertainment is to take down everything. And I think he does this really well. He takes down everything. To valorize storytelling, then, is to hope that something exists in literature that could distract us from our own emptiness. For such valorization not just shuns the activist taking of obdurate position, it apparently also shuns the opposite: open-endedness, ambivalence, nuance, envy, what Joseph calls social frailties. The discomfort with oneself as a westernized Indian, the fear of boredom, the alienation from the dominant currents of political opinion of both the left and the right, the belief in the ultimate justice of the free market, all these seem to come together in the propagation of storytelling, which now means much more than just the folksy longing for a beginning, middle, and end. To reject one's modernity, as Joseph does, to say that we are a civilization that was destroyed, and so we know what we are when we are ancient, but we don't know what we are when we are modern, is a sentiment interestingly incongruous with Kiran Nagarkar's 7/6 of 43, even though in the way that his character tries to forge his own meaning out of his relationships and his experiences of poverty and cruelty, this is a novel about a search for a modern identity. What makes the search compelling is that it is not foreclosed by any of the available formulations regarding what is or is not Indian. Nagarkar, or his character, Purandare, is truly fascinated by what it means to be human in general, while also completely absorbed in day-to-day local reality. Early in the novel, Purandare says to the you he is often addressing, that is one or the other of the various women he has loved and left. Quote, you see people in groups, in countries, in societies, Indians, Englishmen, Spaniards, Germans, Chinese, and then Caucasians, Semites, Mongolians. Perhaps your training as a sociologist has something to do with that. I see only human beings as individuals, isolated, occasionally in groups. At best, I'm a practicing human being. Nothing else. I don't understand the Indian subcontinent. It doesn't exist for me. It doesn't worry me. Kushank Purandare's reading, and these names are scattered like clues through the book, seems to consist largely of the European modernists. Haldor Laxness, Elias Canetti, Per Lagerquist, and Albert Camus. He does not read these as an Indian trying to internalize the West, but matter-of-factly. They come across as inherent to his environment as Hindustani classical music is, or the films of Satyajit Ray. If Manu Joseph is able to hold forth on literature without ever talking about actual books, literature as a series of positions rather than a history of texts, then Nagarkar shows the opposite tendency here in his interest in literature as an experience rather than an argument. But nothing in this experience, the experience of reading or creating literature, is in the nature of an event. The word that Amit uses in his concept note for this symposium, quote, we lived in an ethos in which the event was of primary significance, and whatever was significant had to be construed as an event of some sort, unquote. So if storytelling hinges on event, then this novel is instead about incident and the seeming randomness of life's incidents. Quote, it frightens me to think what small and irrelevant things change the flow of our lives, he says at one point. Nagarkar's second novel, which came 2 decades later, Ravan and Eddie, begins with an event, however, a child's birth, and on the night of independent India's first Christmas Eve. So we can't help but wonder what it might owe to that other, older midnight novel. But it appears that this date has no special significance for Nagarkar. Whereas Salman Rushdie's hero in Midnight's Children, Salim Sinai, is born, quote, mysteriously handcuffed to history, unquote, precisely because he is born just as India is freed, in the case of Ravan and Eddie, 1947 is little more than a chronological marker. And the departure of the British makes no noticeable difference to the lives lived in one of Bombay's colonial era tenements, the Central Works Department Chawl. Further, even though, like Sinai, Eddie is born in melodramatic circumstances, as his father's dead body is being taken to the cemetery and before his mother can get to hospital, these two narratives are markedly different in one other respect. The myth-making in Midnight's Children is driven by the author's project of merging history with personal destiny, while in Ravan and Eddie, the myths emerge from within the imagination of the two leading child protagonists. Salim Sinai may delight for other reasons, but he is never really allowed a child's psychology, whereas Ravan and Eddie slowly stumble up before our eyes. Nagarkar's ability to speak and feel from within the mind of his child characters is brilliantly illustrated by the legend of Ravan the murderer. As a bubbly one-year-old, Ravan leaps out of his mother's arms and flies straight from the balcony of the fourth floor of the chawl and into the arms of aircraft mechanic Victor Coutinho down below. Ravan survives, but Victor dies from the shock of the impact. His wife, Violet, spends the next couple of decades in grim mourning, and their two children, Eddie and Pieta, grow up fatherless and poor. Close neighbors, Ravan and Eddie, are thus fated to be enemies. The fact that Ravan, as an infant, in some sense killed Eddie's father, is revealed to him only when he is 10 years old. A little earlier, in a scene unrelated to this great revelation, he tries to persuade his friend Chandrakant Dixit to join the revivalist Hindu Sabha in return for the bribe of a fountain pen and an illustrated storybook that the Sabha leader has promised him. Hearing him try to lure his son, Ravan is shouted out of the Dixit house by Chandrakant's father. And he tells Ravan, "Sala, you bloody murderers of Mahatma Gandhi." Yes, yes, you don't pretend to be so surprised. You murdered the Mahatma. You have the gall to come to my house and preach the gospel of the Sabha. So now Ravan is responsible for the murder of Mahatma Gandhi. When he's later told he also did away with Eddie Kutunu's father, he acquiesces, though he has no memory of either of these two events, when he killed Gandhi and when he killed Victor Kutunu. Ravan will acquire fame among his peers as a murderer of both Gandhi and Victor. And this fame will occasionally become a source of power for the boy, yet it will cloud his life and dog him till his adult years, a misunderstanding of childhood that has hardened into fate. Ravan and Eddie nevertheless end up becoming friends because both resolutely believe that they are destined to be famous showmen. Imagining personal success in terms of success in Bombay show business is crucial to this novel and its sequels, as making it in, say, Charles Dickens' early industrial London consisted of triumphing over impecunious origins and avaricious capitalists and becoming a gentleman. This hope that films hold out, at least the Hindi films of the 1950s and 60s that he alludes to, is a humanist one, that the underdog will make it, not just despite his rough beginnings, but also regardless of his ethnic identity, cultural identity. Ravan and Eddie are Hindu and Christian, so the furniture of their worlds, as it were, is different, but this difference does not script their fates. This is an interesting contrast to a latter-day Bombay Chawl novel, Joseph's Serious Men, where almost everything that his anti-hero Ayan Mani says and does hinges on his being Dalit. Nagarkar belongs to what Manu Joseph calls empathy incorporated. But this empathy is not sentimental compassion for the poor, rather an expression of the same humanism that in his first novel takes the form of a youthful angst at societal injustices and conventions, and which in Ravan and Eddie makes joy rather than anger the key emotion. Both these novels then are expressions of what has been called Bombay modern. There is palpably the same modernist fascination for the immediate and the quotidian, evident in, say, the poems of Nagarkar's longtime friend and colleague in advertising, Arun Kolatkar. One is inclined to describe Nagarkar as a Bombay modern rather than a Marathi one, not just because he writes in two languages, but also for his disavowal of an identity connected with any one language or ethnicity. He is also a Bombay modern in his relationship to the past. The urge to make the past contemporary, to revisit it, not so as to reinforce any notion of prior, say, pre-colonial Indian glory, but in order to test its accessibility to us, is what drives Kiran Nagarkar's third novel, Cuckold. One way in which he draws this medieval history close is through what he calls an easy colloquial currency of language. The characters in this novel, Cuckold, curse with words like damn, and think in terms of adages like Nero fiddled while Rome burned. This is 16th century Rajasthan. And as much as the historical particulars are clearly evoked, this is no costume drama or period piece. So such contemporaneity does two things. It gives us a sense of the crown prince or the Maharaj Kumar, the figure at the center of the drama from the inside, as a passionately preoccupied figure, bedeviled by doubts, intelligent, sensuous, and lonely. And it brings alive the dynamism of the period being described. The Kumar, even as he is trying to rein in his Krishna-besotted wife and win wars from Mewar, is engrossed in questions to do with the foolishly anachronistic aspects of Rajput chivalry. He is a man of the moment, and this is not a timeless kingdom of yore, but one caught in a many-pronged conflict featuring older Muslim rulers of North India, such as the Khiljis and the Lodis, the first Mughal, Babur, and several other neighboring Hindu states. This is a situation which seems to call not just for new ways of fighting wars, but also new definitions of the self. In a wonderful epiphanic passage, the prince talks of how he had gods for heroes as a child, but when he grew up, he realized the gods are inalterable. Quote, "Their lives were turbulent, but the quality of their experience rarely warped, bent, or changed the way they looked at things. Their minds were impervious. Little, if anything, seeped in." Unquote. And that is the critical contrast, the ever-shifting situation of the mortals versus the timeless nature of the gods. Perry Anderson, in his well-known essay on historical fiction published in the London Review of Books some years ago, described Giuseppe Lampedusa's 1916 novel Leopard as the greatest historical novel of the century for its interlocking, rare in general for the genre, of the historical and existentialist registers. Cuckold manages to do the same. It is an existential novel about life as a Rajput prince in the 1500s, or conversely, it is a historical novel about the sorrow of being in an incompatible marriage and living in an unsympathetic realm. In a recent interview, Nagarkar said that after he finished the novel, he remembers telling his partner that everything in it was true. This is interesting to consider alongside his remark in the afterword to the novel that the last thing I wanted to do was write a novel of historical veracity. He goes on to say in the interview that by true, he means he was striving for not historical, but artistic authenticity. Now, what could that imply in relation to an epic work of storytelling? Moving beyond both event and incident, I want to go back to a word I used a little earlier, situation. The situation in Cuckold and in Nagarkar's other novels is the human one. Nagarkar's experiments with different forms and styles in these three novels and his ability to incorporate both high and low registers is evidence of writerly virtuosity, but it also suggests a restless search for the perfect vehicle to express this artistic authenticity in the cause of his humanism. If the propagation of storytelling furthers the myth that everyone is potentially a storyteller, and so literature is indistinguishable from life, then Nagarkar shows how much art must be brought to bear on the question of which are the stories worth telling. But if the novel's art is considered a way of thinking of moral problems practically through storytelling, then Kiran Nagarkar does tell stories. I'm drawing here on Susan Sontag, who in her essay At the Same Time discusses how the delineation of borders in the novel, its essentially limited and particular structure, its inevitable setting in a particular time and space, subverts that bizarre reality engendered by globalization and the globalized media of a constant now and an always here. And this is what distinguishes literature from the stories the media tells. And I'll quote a bit from her essay. By presenting us with a limitless number of non-stopped stories, the narratives which the media relates, the consumption of which has so dramatically cut into the time the educated public once devoted to reading, offer a lesson in amorality and detachment that is antithetical to the one embodied by the enterprise of the novel. Here then is an argument for storytelling, which is that it is an ethical act, and its ethics consists in taking responsibility for selection and providing insight through closure or completion. Sontag rejects what she calls the spurious cultural geography of a borderless world. And Kiran Nagarkar, in being at once a storyteller and against storytelling, is able to make the worlds of his novels both scrupulously particular and widely resonant.
Thank you, Anjum, for that really close reading of Nagarkar, which is also at the same time very wide-ranging. I think finally somebody had to distinguish storytelling against storytelling and put it in the context of the market, which was a kind of a silent subtext throughout the symposium so far, but it has come across. I mean, incidentally, I was on a panel this Tuesday with one of Joseph's publisher, and he was telling that how difficult it was for them to sell 5,000 copies of his novel. He was talking specifically about his second novel, and I'm just starting to wonder that the populist project was not going as well as it was to. But I'm also very glad that you talk about the distinction between the event and the incident, and that's really fascinating, and hopefully we'll hear more about it, and the idea that, you know, to what degree one needs a departure from the everyday, because the event in many ways is a departure from the everyday, and to what degree a departure from the everyday is a condition for storytelling. And one of the big, you know, kind of conundrums for narrative theorists have been that whether the everyday can be narrated or whether a departure from it is an essential precondition for narratability. There's nothing to narrate, you know, once there's a deviation that becomes worth narrating. So, you know, those are questions that were going to my mind. But I want to really open it up to the audience, you know, because there's so much to think about, and hopefully there are questions about that, about Anjum's paper.
Anjum, this was a very close reading of Kiran's text and so on. But I want to try and take you beyond the text a little bit. Because just as you participated with Manu on Literary Symposium and at the Lit Fest, on the fringes of the Lit Fest, Nagarkar has been speaking at length at various forums as well. And one of the things that he has been doing, and going back to what Amit said earlier this morning, which was literary activism. He's actually been very strongly pleading for activism. So the novels that he's done, I mean, you could call The Cuckold as a historical novel, which is set in 16th century Rajasthan, and the question of 7 into 6 is in 43, as describing life about a person who's kind of down and out and the many lives and loves that he's had, and Ravan 80, of course. But so what do you make of this, and it seems to me that the novels don't kind of lead up to what he's been trying to say outside of these novels. How do you reconcile this? You know, that's what's important, because there's a clarion call. I listened to him at the Times Lit Fest here, and that was a clarion call. Literally, he asked us to take positions on, you know, some of the questions of the day. The event, as, you know, Saikat was saying, moment of the day.
I think Nagarkar is a very interesting case to study of how an author's pronouncements in the media or in conversation or even just forwards and afterwards that he has written himself to his books, how you situate those in relation to his works, because I think he's a very bizarre and sort of almost contrarian sort of figure in relation to his own work. He seems, yeah, I don't know, I don't think he's the best spokesperson of his own work, frankly, because I think, I don't know, maybe it's partly because he really is different people and we're imagining there is one person called Kiran Nagarkar. Because I think in the later works, as well as the fact that he has become much more of a public figure now than he was, he's felt the need to also make these sort of quasi-political statements and take positions about everything, whether it's the war in the Middle East or it's communalism in India, or it's water scarcity. I mean, you just name it. And sometimes this becomes this sort of curious hodgepodge, and you actually don't know if he's really being serious about any of these positions, or he's feeling a certain moral obligation as a writer in the public space to say, I'm a good guy, I'm the good guy, I'm for all of these things. So actually that wishy-washy liberalism is on display sometimes in Kiran Nagarkar, the person. And another possible theme actually to develop would be to look at the ambivalence or the sort of the gaps, elisions between the work and what the author says about the work. I remember Orhan Pamuk talking about this in Naive and Sentimental Novelist, this wonderful book of essays really, and he says he gets great joy out of seeing writers tie themselves into knots about their work, while at the same time trying to maintain a degree of anonymity, open-endedness, not actually own up to everything, while not close all possible interpretations. So I think in Nagarkar case, that would be very interesting to do. So the word you use, reconcile, I don't know why I would want to, I would not necessarily want to reconcile his, the things he said and the books he's written. I think they're interestingly irreconcilable.
Shumona had a question.
Yeah.
Shumona.
This is not related to Nagarkar, but a quote from Manu Joseph, where he's talking about what constitutes the literary. As someone who's literary editor of the Caravan, and someone who's invested in what Amit Choudhury has called the literary novel as an invention by the market, do you think we are witnessing a moment where we need to redefine, or not we, but where the literary is being redefined, because the quote from Manu Joseph, we have so far understood the literary as something inside the text.
Yeah.
What he says about winning awards or creating boredom in readers is something that is supposed to be the effect of the text. So are we witnessing that moment, you think?
I think it also, yeah, I absolutely, but I also think it's based on a curious illiteracy, because he has often also said that he doesn't read Indian English fiction. I mean, he finds the prose very collegiate and dull, and you know, it's over familiar and it's banal, so he can't actually get into it. So is this curious sense of expertise based on ignorance? Like, I will not read it, but I have a lot to say about it. And I think when he talks about the literary and dismisses the literary novel or the serious novel, it's doing a disservice both to himself and to the works of writers like Nagarkar, which is not, I mean, it's not, you can't really slot that as literary or not literary. So I think we also have to ask ourselves, what do we mean when we, is that not already falling into a sort of trap created by the market? Because it's really only in a bookshelf, in a bookstore, that the idea of the popular novel or the literary novel becomes important, right? The bestseller, the popular right in front, and then serious novel somewhere in the middle, and then poetry at the back. So that idea, I think, does not work when you bring these terms to bear on individual texts. And which is why I said his idea of talking about literature is not as a series, is not as a series of texts. It's just as gestures, really, as these remarks that he makes that are then provocative and hopefully will get people to then contradict him or to say equally, take equally extreme positions. So I think literary and popular is less useful when talking about the actual books. And it's not possible to have that conversation with someone like Joseph because he hasn't read the books.
And there's a question in the back.
You've talked about his earlier works. What do you think, how would you characterize Jasoda? She takes her children because of the inhuman conditions in her village to live in a Bombay slum. And her husband also gets involved in their hometown with the prince. So there seems to be a repetition of the slum and the prince.
Oh.
Would you have some background on how you classify this novel?
I haven't read Jasoda. Jasoda is Nagarkar's latest novel. Just appeared a couple of months ago. I haven't actually read it. I'm a little worried about this novel, frankly, from what I've read about it. I totally can't say anything for sure because I haven't read it. But from what Kiran has been saying about the novel and the initial reviews I've read, I'm worried if he's somehow Kiran Nagarkar, the public speaker, is now starting to influence Kiran Nagarkar, the novelist. Because you can see that he's feeling the need to write a novel about the dark side of contemporary India in a very sort of deliberate, slightly possibly agenda-driven way, that I must write about, you know, the dispossessed woman, I must write about this figure who's... there's something about, like, she is also a totally desperate figure who then... she attacks her own children or she kills or something. Yeah, so I'm not sure about that novel, but I really have to read it.
So. Makes you feel that.
Yeah. Okay. I really. I don't know if I would. Again, where that the thing of using. Comparative terms. But I certainly think he in many ways, I mean, I think the delight of Kiran Nagarkar, at least in these three novels for me, was that he was unclassifiable. And he didn't seem to be working towards the greatest or the best, or, you know, like, he could have easily gone on to write more historical novels, for instance. given how accomplished Kakkad is, but he didn't. So it's not like anything that he tests in terms of aesthetic or in terms of expertise and succeeds in, he seems immediately to want to undo that. So actually he's working against the idea of the greatest, the best, you know, the most sort of celebrated. Yeah, he interestingly undermines himself, at least in these early works, yeah.
Anjum, thank you for that really thought-provoking and entertaining talk. So he is a bilingual writer, right?
Yeah.
Kiran Nagarkar. And the first novel you mentioned was a Marathi novel. Translated by himself into English?
No, it was translated by, I think the translator is called Sulabha Slee. Okay. It wasn't translated.
What's the date of publication of that?
1974.
1974, so before the whole Anglophone boom,
yeah,
in the novel begins,
yeah,
in India,
yeah,
and before the novel becomes conflated with Indian writing,
right,
through that boom. Okay, so and it's a short novel. Isn't
it's a very
it?
Short novel.
I haven't
novel.
Read him. I'm ashamed,
yeah,
to say.
Yeah.
We talk about embarrassment. embarrassment. So embarrassed to say that I haven't read him. I want to. But I have seen, one of the things I first look at in books is their size.
Mm.
And I was struck by that it's a short novel. And you know, strangely kind of exhilarated by the fact that's the first, one of the first things that send a signal to me. So that seemed to be enough for them. And for me, in my head, placed him with a particular kind of practice which sort of vanished after that boom. Where would you place him in relation to the form of that first novel, also in relation to the Marathi avant-garde and other avant-gardes in India, in Indian languages, where that kind of form and formalistic, besides linguistic, formalistic kind of preoccupations were pursued? And where would you put that in relation to the English writing, which where he produces novels which are no doubt extremely interesting, as you've just proved, but also look more novel-like in the sense,
yeah,
that we understand the novel today?
I don't think in the English criticism of 7/6 are 43, to the extent that I've read it, it's seen in association with other Marathi novels or poetry or Marathi literature of the period that was also modernist and avant-garde-ish in this way. I don't know how it was received in the Marathi sphere itself, except for the fact that it has recently been reissued. And there's a very interesting afterword by Nagarkar himself, where he completely distances himself from the Marathi sphere. And that I find very interesting, because he's not really saying, I was more Marathi when I did this, and then I became more English, and not just in language, but also in my concerns. In fact, he's saying that the Marathi readers had no idea what hit them. And at least three critics, he says, or maybe more, wrote reviews asking, why couldn't he not have written a linear story? What is this? It makes no sense. What is he trying to do? So he seems to be saying that I was working against the tradition even there. And like I quoted at the beginning, that's from the afterword as well, from the forward as well. Did I say afterword or forward? I've forgotten, but it's somewhere in the book. This person who said it's going to be translated into English, but first it should be translated into Marathi. So, and again, this is very typical of Kiran in some ways. And I'm not saying it's untrue, but he leans towards this sort of self-mythology where he's doing something that is being done for the first time and very few people are going to understand it, and he's going to fail anyway, and so he has to start all over again. And that is already, of course, it's retrospective because that forward appeared now, but certainly he himself is not seeing... there's no sense of feeling at home in the Marathi tradition and doing this as a response. In fact, he's talking about Virginia Woolf and reading her novels and stream of consciousness and feeling like...
But that shouldn't be incompatible with being part of a Marathi tradition.
Not at all.
It should be more compatible
absolutely
than being part of the Anglophone tradition,
absolutely,
where they would have read less of Virginia Woolf.
Absolutely. But he is just
more
that...
of history.
Yeah, yeah. I think one would have to ask maybe a Marathi critic how, over time as well, how it's been received. But like I say, in the book itself, there are so many clues. Again, not to Marathi readers, but the whole modernist tradition, yeah. Mm.